Rhema Vaithianathan is the director of the Centre for Social Data Analytics, a research centre that uses data analytics for social impact based at AUT.
Kia ora katoa, katoa. My name is Rhema Vaithianathan. I'm very happy to be here. I've got half an hour just to share with you some of the work we've been doing in our team. I run a Centre for Social Data Analytics, which is here at Auckland University of Technology and now also has a partnership at University of Queensland. Something a little bit about me, I grew up in Māngere and Papatoetoe. I went to school in Māngere Intermediate, as it used to be called now, Southern Crafts Campus, and then went to high school at Epsom Girls because my parents decided I needed a girls-only school to go to for some reason. But I used to be shipped out with lots of other girls from my area in Māngere and Papatoetoe to go to Eggs. And I went to University of Auckland for my undergraduate master's and PhD, and then I went to Australia after that. So that's me trying to look cool when I was 20. So it's really nice to come here. I love being at AUT. I'm very committed to us having a South Campus. My sister went to MIT, and so we've been in this area for a very long, at least my family have been very connected to this area for a long time. So I think AUT having a campus presence here and being a part of the community here is a very important reason why I moved from the University of Auckland to AUT, and I really appreciate you coming and listening to what AUT is all about. AUT is really about trying to make a difference in the world. So unlike other universities, you know, some of my colleagues from really top-ranked universities that I collaborate with say, I can't believe what AUT allows you to do. And that's because they basically let me do things that aren't always going to end up in a top journal article, you know? Like there's a paper in my field produced every 3 minutes. Every 3 minutes, there's a new journal article out there. Every 3 minutes, some researcher around the world is producing something. And to be honest, especially in this post-Trump world, the degree to which any of the scientific literature, a tsunami of scientific evidence, is actually making a difference in our world is pretty limited. In fact, if you think about it, a lot of what this elite approach to science is doing is polarizing our world. And I say that to a lot of people when I go into meetings with sort of senior research groups and things. You don't find people who have the lived experience in these high rises in Manhattan, right? Like, it's just elites talking to elites. And I think AUT and part of what I do is try to say, well, actually, I'm very interested in supporting frontline workers, building data science tools, bringing research to frontline workers who work with families and communities to improve the quality of decision making that what's now called street level bureaucrats do. So street level bureaucrats are people on the street who have got inordinate amount of power. It's the orangatamariki social worker, right? It's the school counselor. It's the general practitioner. It's these people on the street who are dealing with families, actually, who often make decisions that have minimal oversight, you know, minimal kind of questioning of how those decisions are being made. And part of what I'm passionate about is getting data and tools and science to people in that kind of setting, rather than me writing to other people like me who ain't gonna make any, you know, a teeny bit of difference in the world in which we live. So I'm going to talk in the next 20 minutes about two projects that I've been working on, sort of big data. So big data, machine learning, data science is sort of what I do. We also teach it. We have a really unusual minor in data analytics, which we've just started, which is a minor for people doing social sciences and humanities, so that even people coming without any background in data, in fact, who've often been turned off maths, you know, can come and sort of be walked through what it means to have data in this world. Because to be honest, as I say to my students, even if you're not a producer, you know, even if you're not a consumer, you're not going to work in data, you're producing data every minute of the day on your Facebook, on your Insta, every time you walk through a facial recognition technology, you're producing data. So part of our job is for us to become informed citizens about how that data data is used and produced and manufactured and goes into, you know, the corporate systems that we have said yes to when we share our data. Anywho, I'm going to do two projects we've been working on. The first is very local, working with Counties Manukau. This is sort of a project that we started a few years ago. It's like stalled for a little while, but I'm really keen to restart it. And this is a paper looking at whether we can understand the areas in South Auckland that what we call beat the odds. So it's really easy, and I know from being a South Auckland girl, it's really easy to characterize all our neighborhoods and suburbs as neighborhoods and suburbs that have lots of challenges. I mean, we all, you know, yeah, no shit, we know that, right? So the thing we're trying to figure out in this research is finding out, like, are there neighborhoods and communities in our region who actually do better conditional on the challenges? So we're not saying, okay, you know, you're doing well, you got no challenges. The question is there systems and and neighborhoods where we convert high levels of challenges into better outcomes than we would have expected if that's, you know, if for an ordinary person with those challenges. Are you with me? So we call that beating the odds. And that's a way of recharacterizing the communities we live in. So I have to share this with you. Access to data used in the study was provided by Statistics New Zealand under conditions designed to give effect to the security and confidentiality provisions. And so we accessed this data under strict conditions under the five safes rule. We weren't able to see any identifiable information and so on. So what did we do with this research? We basically took every child born in the maternity wing of Counties Manukau or Middlemore between 2006 and 2011, and we linked that data set to lots of to outcomes for the children in the 2 years following, and lots of information about their parents, from court records, from pharmaceutical records, from Oranga Tamariki records, or MSD as it was at the time, from immunization records. So we built a huge picture of a huge number of children who were born in that cohort. So this is just an example of the, I mean, this is not big data, but it's very rich data in the sense that it's every child born in New Zealand, in this region. So there's good things and bad things. The good thing is that we get a comprehensive picture. The bad thing, we're only restricted to understanding those things that are already held in our government systems about these children. So we defined a poor start to life as having one or more of these things in the child's life in the first 2 years. They weren't immunized. They were hospitalized for ASH is hospital avoidable conditions, things that you really shouldn't go to hospital for. So bronchiectasis, because you shouldn't have bronchiectasis if you're treated well when you're a child, when you first get pneumonia, you know, when you get a cough and a cold. Long injury, maltreatment, or long bone fractures. Those are in 2 year old, long bone fracture suggests something like an abuse indicator. It's things that we are really concerned about, head injuries and so on. They were referred to Oranga Tamariki. The child died, so postneonatal infant mortality or neonatal mortality. Mom, during those first 2 years of life, was sentenced to a crime. Child in those first 2 years of life is not seen in the PHO data. So PHO is where children get enrolled to your GP. If you're not enrolled in a GP for the first 2 years of life, it suggests that, you know, maybe you're off the grid or we're missing something about you. Or you had a police family violence call out. So this is a very restricted, I know, because part of my area of research is maltreatment. So it's kind of focused on those kinds of adversities. So, you know, all of us living in, as many of people in South Auckland know, 2/3 of the children born in South Auckland do not, they have a healthy start to life. They're enrolled, they're immunized, they have no Oranga Tamariki, no family violence call out, they survive. And, you know, as far as we can see in the data, they do, they're fine, they will do well. Another 20% have just one of those things. And 14%, which is the group that we're really concerned about, have two or more of those things happening to them in those first 2 years. And we know that in those first 2 years, the load of stress on children's brain development is really high, right? We know that as they're exposed to violence and those kinds of stresses, that their ability to develop is less. So we don't want this to happen. Now, here's the funny thing. I crosswalked these 14% or these kids across to our home visiting programs. Do you think the majority of these families were getting home visiting programs like our Family Start? Do people know Family Start? Family Start is like the program in South Auckland which we're supposed to be giving to families who have high needs. Most of these kids did not get Family Start. So these kids, these families were on their own coping with these challenges. So then we looked and asked ourselves, could we tell at the birth of this child that this family was going to have challenges? And indeed we could. We took a list of risk factors, and these are the list factors ordered by how important they were for determining that this child was going to experience adversity in those first 2 years. Past criminal history for mum and dad, mental health addiction for mum and dad, mother was smoking while pregnant, was on a benefit within 13 weeks of birth, father not present in the household, a teen mom, low birth weight baby, and a living in deprivation 9 to 10. Now, living in deprivation is the lowest because you can live in deprivation and have a good start to life. This is ranked by what's important. So what this is telling us is that in the data, we could have said which families were going to have challenges. And when we looked at the data, for 2 years, no one gave them services. And this is what we see everywhere, is if you talk to a youth justice judge, they will tell you that they can see the trajectory from birth. And it's not about stigmatizing. This is about breaking intergenerational transmission of disadvantage, which is what our communities are all supposed to be about. So we wanted to know, what are the communities in South Auckland that seem to manage to do that? So what we did is we mapped from our Auckland to who beat the odds. So the idea of beating the odds is, suppose we take all the children born with two or more risk factors across South Auckland. So mum had criminal history, dad wasn't present, lived in Dep 9 and 10, and had, mum who had substance use history. Take those kids, follow them in the data, and see how many of adversities they have. We know they're going to have lots of adversities. We know that. But let's look at the kids who have less than expected number of adversities. And that's where we get my home, Māngere, as beating the odds. So what this shows us is, on the right-hand side, the red areas are the areas where we have very high need families, families with lots of risk factors. So Māngere is lots of risk factors, Takanini is lots of risk factors, Takanini South, Manurewa, lots of risk factors. On the left-hand side, the green are the areas where, even though those communities have lots of risk factors, the kids seem to do better than we would expect. So those are the neighborhoods, the bright spots neighborhoods, they're sometimes called, the neighborhoods that... So is anyone here else from Māngere? All right. do you want to speculate on why you think Māngere might beat the odds?
I think one of the always things that I've been proud of being from Māngere is we had the airport, so all the outside knowledge came into Māngere as well, so.
If
I can contribute to your study, that'd be good.
Thank you. Yeah, you're quite right. So when we shared this with maternity services at Manukau, they kind of think that there's a very long established GP network. Of course, they're health people, so they always think it's the health system that's making a difference. So they thought it was a GP network. The other thing they realized, and we showed them in the data, is there's a large number of women, when they leave prison, end up having children quite early after a prison spell, which you can understand happens. But actually, there was an opportunity there for Counties Manukau to provide better services for women as they leave prison, because then they can provide them and engage with them early rather than waiting till later. So that's one part of our research, which is looking at big data. The other is building data machine learning tools. So why do people want the types of tools that we use? Well, even in a school setting now, people are really looking at data and evidence-led as education. So I've heard from, I think it was the principal of Sylvia Park. Is anyone from Sylvia Park here? No, there was a really interesting webinar the other day on literacy. You know, New Zealand has very challenging levels of literacy. I think 35% of 15-year-olds were found not to have functional literacy, and they were discussing what they could do about it, and the principal of Sylvia Park was saying actually what they've been doing at Sylvia Park is using data much more informedly, understanding trajectories and trends and what approaches were most best for what sorts of children. That's sometimes called education analytics, learning analytics. Has anyone heard about that? So that's where you use kind of machine learning data science tools. It's kind of the same thing that helps you Google, get you to here, right? It's like it gives you an estimate of how long it'll take. Same principles. Learning analytics is just saying, here's 100 other kids like this kid who's taken this job, who's been given this career, and you know what? 75% of them love their job. So that gives you some sense of what you should be doing, whereas as career advisors, you're all going back into your bank of 20 kids who've done this, right? Whereas big data, you can find 1,000 kids who've taken this career route. And isn't that more informative? I mean, you still know more about that child than your analytics tool, but the analytic tool says, for kids like this, we data mine the hell out of thousands of careers and say, this is the kind of career that would suit. So we kind of do the same thing in child protection. The reason is because at the moment, when Orangatawari caseworkers or child protection caseworkers go out there, they have a mountain of information they're supposed to collect. They're supposed to collect information about the parents, about history, and all of this stuff. But actually, they're not told how to use that information. And what you get when you don't know how to use an information is you get information overload. The quality of your decision making goes down as a result of information overload. So what happens when our frontline workers or our street level bureaucrats are making hundreds of decisions every day based on fast decision making and information overload? They do what's called heuristics. They use mental shortcuts. One of the biggest mental shortcuts is racial stereotyping. And that's what we found in literature, research all around the world, is people use mental shortcuts because they can't get their arms around the whole context of the person. So for example, the paper on the right was written by two economists at Harvard, and they did the following experiment. They sent identical CVs, and because your career is a writer, you might find this interesting. They sent identical CVs to a whole lot of employers, identical. The only difference was that some of them had black names and some of them had white names. In the US, there is quite a typical types of names that are associated black and African American people. There was a statistically significant, considerably large gap in callback for interviews just because you had a black name, identical CVs. The woman who did this, Jennifer Eberhard, if you're interested in bias, her work is fantastic. I used it a lot. It's she did a really interesting data piece where she took how police officers stopped a random drivers in Oakland, California. She took the full script. And she used machine learning to classify how often things they would say things like ma'am and sir, how often they would use a polite language versus how often they would use aggressive language. When they stopped black people, they systematically, for the same reason, they, for the start of the conversation, where they didn't know this person from Joe, they started with more aggressive language. So that's kind of a concept of these people. When you're a frontline, when these people who are called frontline bureaucrats, we give them a lot of power, right? We say, yes, you can stop whoever you want, you can talk to them whatever way you want, right? Think of how much we control our governments. Think of how much we hold them to account and how little we hold the account of police people every day who are interacting with citizens. Caseworkers every day who are interacting with citizens, teachers every day who are interacting with citizens, how little we account for their behavior and their interactions and how well they're doing. Zero. Zero. So that's the question that my research is very interested in. And I don't do it because I think they are malign or willful. I do it because we're not solving the problem for them. Their problem is they're having to make decisions every 10 minutes. In highly emotional states where they're highly challenged. We don't give them tools to help them make better decisions. And that's where a lot of my work comes in, and we've been doing work in Colorado and California and Pennsylvania building these machine learned decision tools. And here's an example of one. When a call comes in a couple of places in Colorado, Pennsylvania, and Los Angeles, the referral to a child protection hotline is entered into the database exactly like they always do. And we've built a tool that helps the frontline worker stratify whether this family is at high risk of future maltreatment, fatality, or removal or not. And so the tool is pretty good at picking up removal. If a child scores a 20, they're at 40 times more likely to be removed from home for maltreatment in the next 2 years than if the child scores 1. And yet, you know what we found? We found that if a child scores a 1 and they're black, they're much more likely to be investigated than the identical child who's white and scores a 10. So what we've done is by giving this tool, and we're working with PhD students in the US, we've shown that the introduction of this tool has reduced racial disparities, because now I see a black family, but I also see a 1. So now I can say, well, actually, maybe this family is not at risk. And you know what we found? We found that as a result of this tool, white people who are at high risk are more likely to be investigated. They were ignoring white families who were at incredibly high risk until it was too late. So this gave us an idea. So again, these are not frontline workers who want to be malign. It's just you use the heuristics if you're being asked to make decisions. And the color of a face, the kind of memes that are out there about families of different color, from different zip codes, make it into your decision making. You can't help it. It's human nature. We are hardwired to use heuristics. So we have to give tools and data and evidence and make them pause and ask themselves, hang on, okay, I see it's a black family, I see it's a family from a poor zip code, but hey, they might be the one family that beats the odds, like we did before. All right, so this is kind of the front, this is the screen of what we do. And so, thank you, everyone. I'll just leave you a little bit about CSDA. We're a Center for Social Data Analytics. We have loads of collaborations from around the world, and a lot of our work, if you're interested, you can look us up. We're New York Times and Nature, and we were in the Scientific American edition of a special issue of Race in last year. So we've been kind of working in this area now. I've been working in this area for decades, and CSDA has been, so I developed CSDA to try to pull a lot of this work together and deploy a lot of tools in frontline work. So thank you very much.